I think the Prime Minister has made a catastrophic mistake here in starving detail from the Australian public. I think there are millions of Australians who just want to know what it is they're being asked to vote for. This is the biggest change to our constitution in 120 years. It's a new chapter being inserted into the constitution. It means that our whole system of government will change because the voice, as Megan Davis and others have pointed out, these are the handpicked people by the Prime Minister who sit on the committee that have designed this thing. They have been very open about it by its very design. The voice is going to have the ability to have a say on every area of government responsibility. The expansive words that have been put into the Constitution can't be undone by any bill that passes the Parliament. Our nation's rule book is the most important thing in our country at the moment. Let's be very clear about it, and it has been from 1901. It's allowed us to be a free and democratic nation. It's allowed a freedom of speech, and it's allowed a rule of law to be enforced that is the envy of the world. People come to our country because of the system of government we have. The lifestyle here in Fadden is the envy of many people around the world. And if the Prime Minister is proposing a voice, which is going to be a Canberra-based voice, then he needs to explain how it will work. And at the moment, his decision to not provide that detail means that it's going to be lost, in my judgment, and on all of the evidence that we see at the moment. Or in the best case scenario for the yes case, it'll be 51-49, which means in effect that our country is split down the middle. And the Prime Minister is making a decision at the moment which is dividing our country, not uniting our country. And what we're saying is that the two parties could come together, provide constitutional recognition, and we could work together in legislation around the voice to allow local and regional bodies to be heard so that we can make a positive and practical difference on the ground in those Indigenous communities. All of us want a better outcome for Indigenous Australians, particularly in regional and remote areas. But at the moment, the Prime Minister is taking our country down a divisive path. He says that our international reputation will be harmed and that the reconciliation cause will be set back if the referendum is unsuccessful in October. I agree that it sets back reconciliation. And if the Prime Minister is set on that course, going to an election or going to a referendum election, knowing that it's going to fail and that reconciliation will be set back, he should delay it or pull it back altogether. And we've asked decent, respectful questions. I wrote to the Prime Minister more than 6 months ago, asking 15 questions on behalf of millions of Australians, still no response. We asked Minister Burney over 20 questions in question time this week, no coherent response. And the legal uncertainty and ambiguity here is quite remarkable. And to change the constitution in this way is without precedent. There's been no constitutional referendum. There's been no guarantees, and there can be no certainties or guarantees about the limitations because by design, it does cover every area of government. So I think the Prime Minister needs to really take a long, hard look, stop the hubris, and start acting in our country's best interests.
When I spoke at GAMA last year, and I go back to that speech, one of the things I said then is, if not now, when? Mm. 1967, we had a referendum where Indigenous Australians were counted for the first time in various census and other activities. We had the apology in 2008 as the first act of the new government. When you look at constitutional recognition, John Howard spoke about that last century. It's now 2023. I outlined last year a timetable that included very clearly introduction of legislation in March, a committee process between March and June, and then a Senate process to adopt it. I note that when the Senate passed the legislation for a referendum this year, what it did was, this week, there were no votes on any amendments put forward. None. The National Party decided last year they would oppose it before they knew what the question was. And the Liberal Party decided at the executive level that they would oppose it regardless of what came out of the committee process before it had even begun. There are Indigenous Australians who have spent decades. Arnie Pat Anderson, Noel Pearson, Marcia Langton, and others. I had here yesterday with the Barunga statement, the leaders of the four land councils in the Northern Territory, who have all, Central Land Council, Northern Land Council, and others, all presenting a new Barunga statement to this parliament, saying yes. The idea that you will just keep this process going forever, a process the majority of which has occurred while the coalition was in government. The coalition established a joint parliamentary committee chaired by Julian Lisa and Senator Pat Dodson. We had the Tom Carmer and Marcia Langton report that went to cabinet not once but twice, established by the former government. You had lots of opportunities. I spoke with then Prime Minister Morrison on the first day of the parliamentary sitting in 2019, the only time I entered that office during that term. And I said then, if you want to advance this, which was a commitment from the coalition, and nothing happened in terms of no legislation, let alone a referendum. I say, if not now, when? We can get this done. And when it's done, Australians will recognise Indigenous Australians in our constitution. And the other thing that it will do is it will allow for us to have the opportunity to listen to the voice of Indigenous Australians on matters that affect them. And so I'm committed to having a referendum. The legislation has been passed, and I've said, as I've said now continually, the referendum will take place in the last quarter of this year.